Carolina University with Civil War Talk Radio. Today's guest has taught American history and other subjects at Union College, at Harvard, at Brandeis, Brown University, University of Richmond, Wofford College, City University of New York, the Citadel, and Wesleyan University. She's also a member of the Screen Writers Guild, a writer of children's books, and a frequently published historian whose most recent work is a biography of Harriet Tubman. Join us with the much-traveled Catherine Clinton when we return on Civil War Talk Radio.
Onboard computers to improve fuel efficiency and reduce emissions.
Check.
Acoustic and optical wayside monitors to enhance safety.
Check.
Robotic systems to measure track geometry.
Check.
GPS tracking and tracing systems.
Check.
Sounds like a rocket or a jet getting ready for takeoff, doesn't it? Actually, it's something just as technologically advanced. A freight train. There's a new world of technology riding the rails that makes today's freight railroads more fuel efficient, safer, and cleaner running than ever. With wireless communications, transponders, and trackside readers that can pinpoint a shipment's location at speeds of up to 80 miles an hour, North America's freight railroads are driving the technology required by today's businesses and consumers. And with everything from apples to computers moving by rail, we wouldn't have it any other way. Chances are, the things you'll use tomorrow are taking the train today. Tomorrow, arriving by train. Sponsored by North America's Freight Railroads.
Mission critical. Two words that describe the data vital to every e-commerce website. If your company needs the services of an unparalleled co-location facility, you need to remember these two words, Castle Access. With Castle Access, your internet servers will be secure in environmentally controlled data centers that offer high-speed managed internet access and the highest standards of 24/7 customer support. For more info, visit castleaccess.com. Castle Access. We keep you online all the time.
World Talk Radio, bringing the world to you.
World Talk Radio. I'm Jerry Prokopovich at East Carolina University, and with me today is historian Catherine Clinton. Catherine, how are you doing today?
Well, thanks, Jerry.
Good to have you here. I think the last time you and I met in person was back in February 2005, at a White House reception.
That's right.
I don't have anywhere to go with that. I just like to tell people I got to go to the White House.
That's well, being involved with the Lincoln Bicentennial Commission is a great effort and a wonderful enterprise, and it's nice to visit Lincoln's former home once in a while.
It is, and actually I do have somewhere to go with that, because when we were there, the President and First Lady were gracious enough to invite the guests to see the Lincoln bedroom up in the family quarters.
Yes.
Had you ever been there?
No, and it was really wonderful to me because I'm in the midst of working on Mary Todd Lincoln, and so being able to visit some of her other homes. I've spent a lot of time in Springfield recently, and I've been to Kentucky, but it's wonderful to really be in the place and see the bedroom restored with the furnishings as elaborate and ornate as she wanted them to be, and Laura Bush is doing a marvelous renovation of that room to really make it look like a bedroom in Lincoln's time.
Well, that's right. Of course, it was not in Lincoln's time a bedroom at all, was it?
No, but it is the style of furniture that Mary Todd Lincoln is, of course, famous for today, and even, I think, blamed for today. So it was interesting to see that, and of course the desk that he might or might not have penned the Emancipation Proclamation on.
That's right. That was the cabinet room where Lincoln did his work at that time. But now it has that marvelous huge bed that Mrs. Lincoln bought.
Right.
Now, so you're working on a biography of Mary Lincoln?
Yes. Certainly, I was just thinking when I was hearing the strains from the Ken Burns music from his documentary on the Civil War, that it was really the bringing to life the Civil War through film that got me so fascinated by the subject of the Civil War and started me writing Civil War history and brought me to, in a roundabout way, a biography of Lincoln's wife.
Well, let's talk about that a minute. That's a frequent question that I get, that I'm sure you get whenever you talk about Abraham Lincoln, is what's with Mary? Was she as bad a person to live
with? Could she have been as bad? Could she have been everything people say she is? Well, certainly she's such a great conundrum that was one reason to plunge into her life. But her times, I think, are really something that I'm quite interested in. The last two biographies I've done, one on Fanny Kemble and one on Harriet Tubman, were concerned with telling about the life of an extraordinary individual. But I also believe it's important to contextualize. And one of the things I feel about Mary Todd Lincoln is that she needs to be recontextualized. There are many aspects of her personality that perhaps are not as familiar. She was indeed born and reared a Southern belle, and that is something that, of course, my earliest work on plantation mistresses has prepared me for. But one thing I haven't been prepared for is the life and times of spiritualism in the antebellum era, which only escalated during the Civil War, the way in which those who were robbed of loved ones were plunged into an attempt to reach across time and space and to connect with those that had died. And spiritualism was really an incredible movement during the 1850s and into the 60s, and something I'm exploring just now.
So this was something where people believed
they could directly communicate with the spirits of those who had died.
By conducting seances, for example?
Yes, wrapping, spirit circles. But certainly the more flamboyant Barnum-esque aspects are well known, but not the fact that spiritualists outnumbered abolitionists in antebellum America, that women played such an important role, that many of the prominent reformers that we've heard of were great believers in spiritualism, that a New York State Supreme Court judge resigned his seat to become a spiritualist. So I think there really is a lot to be learned about it. And it was the era, of course, in which the telegram was invented and reaching across time and space was a new concept to many Americans. And they thought they could reach across the spiritual time and space as well. So it's something I'm really interested in exploring as part of the context of Mary Todd Lincoln's world.
That's fascinating. I guess that makes sense, that if you live in a world where someone 100 miles away is immeasurably distant, and then suddenly a new invention puts you in simultaneous contact,
right?
If you can annihilate that space, why not break down the barrier between living and dead?
I think a lot of Americans, of course, in recent times have witnessed events that have put them so dramatically in touch with the past. I mean, who among us was not riveted by those people who were trapped in the Twin Towers on their cell phones trying to communicate with loved ones, trying to reach across time and space? So there is, I think, a real need for us to explore what is the context of sudden loss and also trying to maintain that loss. And Mary Todd Lincoln, along with many others, lost loved ones, but her loss of her child, Willie, in the White House, and then, of course, her husband being murdered in front of her, were traumas that I don't think many of us can imagine.
No, and I guess I had not realized how pervasive spiritualism was, that this is not a sort of crackpot fringe movement.
Well, no, and I'm not trying to write a book about spiritualism, but as I said, once you start reading about it and discovering how seriously people took it, how much a part of everyday life it was, how very, very much it fit in with evangelical Christianity and was not in conflict with it during the 19th century, then you begin to get a really different view of Mary Todd Lincoln and her various attempts to commune with those she'd lost.
Right. That if the First Lady tried to do that today, we would say this is, well, I guess when Nancy Reagan supposedly consulted an astrologer,
surely,
for
yeah.
policy, people thought that was perhaps a silly thing to do.
Right.
But your point is that with Mary, Lincoln did the same thing in the 19th century when everybody was doing it, or
right.
many people were. It's not.
And
eerie.
It may be that she wasn't the first lady to reach out, because, of course, Jane Pierce had lost her son tragically between her husband's election and inauguration, and she went to the White House in great grief for her lost son.
She essentially spent all 4 years hidden away, as I understand it, or in mourning Mrs. Pierce did. Is that accurate?
Absolutely, yes.
So again, in context, Mary's very intense mourning for Willie after his death in 1862 is not as out of the mainstream.
It was extreme, but it certainly wasn't out of the ordinary. There were many people who were as obsessed with death and loss, and of course it was a national obsession during the Civil War.
In terms of context, the loss of children certainly something it's very hard to grasp how painful that is, but it was a much more common experience.
Absolutely, in 19th century. But I think, you know, thinking about the Civil War, imagine how we in the 21st century think about our children and cosset them as Americans and treasure them. In the 19th century, it wasn't as if they were disposable, but they certainly were. They certainly died at such high rates that people had very different relationships with their young children. And certainly the relationship of children to death and dying in war is very interesting and important. I'm thinking of Jim Martin's book on children in the Civil War, mm-hmm. a book that came out about a decade ago, and everyone was thinking we knew everything about the Civil War, but I guess we certainly don't, as new and interesting books come out every year that prove us wrong, really. I'm really pleased to be seeing a great revival and flourishing in Civil War studies, that they're broadening and deepening with each passing publishing season.
It's
I have
true.
A stack on my desk that's really remarkable. I'm thinking of Margaret Creighton's book, The Colors of Courage, about immigrants and women and blacks at Gettysburg. Hmm. Ann Rubin has a new book on the rise and fall of the Confederacy, really looking at Confederate nationalism, I think, in a very sophisticated way in light of independence and nationalist movements today. Mm-hmm. So, you know, lots of good things in the works.
That's right. As we move further in time from the Civil War, we lose a little immediacy every year, but we gain different perspectives. And the thriving of nationalist movements today, the breakup of the Soviet Union in the past decade, certainly do shed a different light on secession than one might have had 50
right.
years earlier.
And what some people even still will be willing to call the war for Southern independence. And I'm not saying that that is the way we should term it in our new books, but I am saying that I think it's really interesting to try to regauge and recalculate what feelings were at that time. A few years ago, I did a book called Southern Families at War. I edited an anthology, and it was really amazing to see the way German families related to the Confederacy, Jewish families related to the Confederacy. I even had a piece in there by Ted Owenby on the way the Confederate male imagined heaven. And so I think, you know, really trying to think about the struggles people had within their times to redefine themselves and the way in which white Southerners may have had an ideology, which is something we might study as an historical artifact, not, of course, divorcing it from racial attitudes, race consciousness that went on during that period, but I think expanding and really deepening our appreciation of what the conflicts were during the 1860s.
That's right. I think a lot of people are drawn to history initially out of a nostalgic desire to live for the moment in a time when everything was simple, when moral questions were easy, there was right and there was wrong. But the more one looks at history, the more quickly realized that was not the case at all.
No.
And that everything was just as ambiguous and difficult. Decisions were not easily reached in any era of our past, and certainly not in the Civil War.
Although, as you mentioned, Jerry, I do write children's books as well. I've done
yeah.
a few on the Civil War, and I was just thinking about a big revival going on John Wilkes Booth, that the American Brutus book has come out by Michael Kaufman, mm-hmm. and I know James Swanson has a book in the works called Manhunt about the 12 days, and I look forward to Terry Alford's work on Booth. But in the children's book field, I just noticed a new book came out called Good Brother, Bad Brother, which is about Edwin Booth and James Wilkes Booth, which sort of shows the way in which sometimes we have simplifications But also, I argue the children can lead us, because I was asked to do an encyclopedia article on Harriet Tubman and discovered that the last adult biography written on her was in 1943.
Well, I want to ask you about that. I'm struck by the image of the good, bad brother as the feature in Highlights for Children.
Right.
Goofus and Gallant. Gallant protects his national leader. Goofus assassinates the president.
Mm-hmm.
That would be a rather extreme version of that, I suppose.
I suppose, yeah.
But in any case, Harriet Tubman, your biography, as you point out, is the first serious treatment of this figure in
America. Well, I don't know how. There were 30 children's books in print, but no adult biography. So when I discovered this writing for the Encyclopedia for the Confederacy, as a matter of fact, I decided it would be important to do something about it. But I was involved in several other projects, and when I turned back to it, I still was amazed that there were new books coming out on Sojourner Truth. There was a biography of Rosa Parks, but still nothing on Harriet Tubman. And of course, one of my great interest was to try and do justice to her long and very vigorous struggle for freedom, which did not just end with the Civil War, that she saw the Underground Railroad going above ground during the Civil War, and I was really interested in her Civil War career, her leading men into battle at the Cumbie River Raid, her involvement in scouting and spying operations in occupied Carolina, and I really do see her as an important and transitional Civil War figure. She, of course, was very involved with veterans organizations after the war and saw herself as a patriotic participant in the larger cause of the Civil War and its struggles for freedom. So it was really, I think, important to contextualize her that way. And then, ironically, working on her in occupied South Carolina, I came across a story which I, of course, knew, that is the first Black Medal of Honor winner, William Kearny. But I found that that story really needed to be told, I thought, to a wider audience, and I've just finished a children's book that'll be out later, the first children's book on the Battle of Fort Wagner, and that's coming out. So it's interesting how my children's books lead to adult books, and adult books lead to children's books, and I really see them all as one large ball of wax to get the great stories of the Civil War out to the wider public, and that also to get children engaged in these marvelous, incredible stories of the past, of heroism and of struggle, which I think we live in a very complex world today, and they are asking questions about these struggles. And so I did a book called Hold the Flag High, and Kearny is a great hero in it, and I think it's great to get these stories out to people of all ages.
I absolutely would agree with that. I think I want to ask you a little bit about Harriet Tubman, since you mentioned that, and that is the recent full-length work you've completed. She is known to students today. I ask my freshman students every year to name 10 figures from American history, and then I ask them now name 10 figures who are not political or military leaders, and that throws them for a loop. They struggle to think of people other than white male political or military leaders, but
right.
They almost always include Harriet Tubman. They've all heard of her.
Right. They've
but
all read those children's books.
They've read the children's
bless
books.
Them that are out there, and I think that she does have a great name value, but I think she's been kept on the children's shelf, and we need to really put her on the in the pantheon of American heroes.
Well, I'd like to come back to that. We're going to take a break here on Civil War Talk Radio. We'll come back and find out more about Harriet Tubman with our guest, Catherine Clinton.